Hey, this is Steve DiGiorgio, bassist of DTA, and you're watching The Age of Metal.
All right, people. This next one is about a machine. Suicide Machine.
Hey everybody, this is Stephanie here with The Age of Metal. I'm here right now at the Orpheum in Tampa, Florida for the DTA tour, and I'm here with Steve DiGiorgio right now. So how are you doing?
Good, thanks. Good to see you.
All right, good to see you too. So you're currently on the tour right now. From what I know, it's almost over. So overall, how has it been, this leg of the tour?
It's been kind of a whirlwind tour, but the support has been amazing.
Nice.
A lot of these places have been filled up, and that shows, you know, that people support this idea of a project that we're doing. It's really cool because, you know, this not being a typical band situation, pushing a new album or any kind of product, you know, it could really go either way. But fortunately, people really understand what we're doing, and it feels good to be accepted and having success. So yeah, it's great.
Nice. And so overall for this tour, from what I know that you play more of the older death era, do you think that for future DTAs will be kind of based off of that, or what do you think?
No, actually we play a mix of everything. We're playing songs off of all 7 death records.
Okay.
Yeah, that was definitely a focus. One of the earlier lineups was me plus 2 other guys that played on the Human record, Paul and Sean from Cynic. And we focused a little more on that album since we were all together, and combined it with mostly older stuff, kind of more or less simulating the Human tour from 91.
Oh, okay.
So that was, you know, that was going on back then. But since we've, you know, integrated new guys, you know, we got Bobby from Symbolic, and Gene played on Symbolic and on Individual with me, and then I was on Individual and Human before. So we have a pretty good span of guys, and so we're playing definitely songs off those 3 albums that we participated in, plus, of course, playing the old ones that people like here, and then, you know, getting a stab at some of the newer ones too. So we try to keep it pretty mixed. It's a better way to honor the whole, you know, story of Chuck,
right?
You know, because every album is pretty much really different from the last one, so to have a good variety of songs in the set kind of keeps it, you know, nice and rounded.
Great, nice. And this is, you got Max again for vocals. Do you think he's going to be permanent, or what do you think?
Well, I mean, Max came in after the initial, you know, we could call it an experimental run at the DTA thing, and once he came on board, I mean, it's pretty hard to find someone to replace him. He does a great job, and you know, he's a top level musician and a great guy. We get along good, and so there's really, you know, to pull out the cliche, I mean, if it's not broken, don't fix it. You know, Max is doing a great job. People accept him. He has a very unassuming personality. Like he doesn't project ego, and that's good to stand up there in Chuck's spot, because we're not trying to replace him. You know, Max does a great job of playing Chuck's parts without trying to trick people that he's trying to be Chuck. And that works good, because we're not about that. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know, permanent? Sure. For now.
For now. Yeah, from what I've, this is my first time seeing DTA, but from the footage that I've seen, I mean, he does an excellent job. So it's really, really great to hear.
Yeah, good, yeah.
All right.
He's always done good for us.
And since you've had plenty of experience on DTA, and since you you know, were, you know, a very iconic figure in the band Death. How do you think, the Death songs that you play on DTA have changed as opposed to when you played them during Death's Legacy?
They've probably changed just by circumstance of time, but we, our goal is to play them the way that we, you know, 50% the way we originally recorded them and 50% the way we played them on the tours following those recordings, because sometimes the song will change immediately after the album's done. But I mean, you know, we're guys in our mid-40s playing what we did when we were in our mid-20s, so there's bound to be a difference. But it's a cool challenge that we take on, because, you know, we're not tricking ourselves that we're back in our mid-20s, but we're playing at high speeds and some intricate stuff, and we're pulling it off. So, you know, from kind of a selfish standpoint, it's cool to be able to do that stuff still.
Yeah,
that's
understandable.
Yeah.
And overall, what do you think is the difference between playing in Death and versus playing in DTA now, with obviously the exception of Chuck?
Well, back then, you know, Death was barely a fraction as big as it is now. Back then it was a normal band fighting and you know, pushing and trying to build a following and you know, create a legacy. Now we are just reminiscing about the legacy. You know, we're playing, you know, even the last album from 98, I think. But most of the songs are generally 20 something years old. You know, so it's different. It's more or less like a cover band playing some nostalgic stuff. I mean, we're the original guys that played those songs back then, so, you know, we didn't have to learn someone else's, some other band's stuff. But other than that, I mean, you know, it's older stuff. So the difference was, back then we, you know, we were fighting to get known like every band does, you know, full of energy, trying to get seen, and now we're just, you know, playing for people and taking them for an hour and a half of nostalgia. And also a lot of people that were probably too young to see Death back in the day when they were a real band. And so they could come out and see a pretty decent facsimile of what it is. So, yeah, it's a big difference. But we suspend disbelief for that little hour and a half and just kind of go back, and people enjoy it. And that's all we're doing, you know, just up there playing something that we used to play, and hopefully that it goes over well.
Do you know, or do you think there'll be anything on Control Denied, if there'll be a memorial for that band, or?
Well, I've been saying one way and the other way for years, so I don't really know. You know, people can trust that those of us that are on the inside, we're trying. We're talking to each other, we're brainstorming, we're getting people involved that understand the different technologies that were originally used to do the second Control Denied record, and it's not really easy to complete it, but even with it not being easy, we're still trying. It's hard and it's dragging on. I don't have like a really definitive answer, but I can tell you that we're not going to give up.
That would be cool to see Control Denied as well as that.
Yeah, I think if we managed to get the record finished, it would be appropriate to maybe something similar to this or incorporate it somehow. I know, once again, Chuck's not here, but, you know, I think he would really approve, because in the phone calls that I had with him in the kind of last year that he was around, he was really excited to go tour with Control Denied. So for the band to get together and, you know, stand up there and play his songs, I think he would give us a nod. Yeah.
Overall, for DTA, when it first came out, I mean, I got the impression that it was just a memorial tour, that it would just happen this time for, you know, just to reflect back on Chuck and Death's legacy. But it seems like it's beyond a yearly tour now. It's all year. It's a full-time touring lineup, and you're going all around the world, it seems. So did you expect it to get this big, or?
Not at all. In fact, your first presumption was correct. We were just going to do a one trip memorial tour. That's all it was. 5 major cities in the U.S. and just call it a day. But the demand was there. Promoters came out representing the people in their area that wanted to see it, and yeah, we just started putting it together. And that's really how this whole thing runs. You know, there's no record company, you know, there's no budgets, there's no, it's really just basically if the voice of the people is loud enough, you know, and the situations are right, we get it together and we go and play. And so, you know, when that voice dies out, then we'll go away happy.
Nice. And with the rise of popularity of the tour, do you think that you'll be doing anything bigger? I know we talked about Control Denied before, but is there anything else that you can tell us?
No. To be honest, I think this is probably it. I don't know. It feels like it's kind of winding down, coming to an end. The attendance has been kind of diminishing. We've toured the U.S. I think this is the, well, counting the memorial, the first initial tour. I mean, this is the fourth time we've been around the States. We've gone to Europe 3 or 4 times. We played South America. You know, we've covered a lot of territories. And we've, you know, rotated the lineup a lot. And there's really nothing left. I mean, like I said, if the voice of the people is there and they want us, that's easy for us. We're musicians. We're performing artists. It's nothing for us to pick up and go play. But as far as the idea of the whole DTA, I mean, it can only live, you know, for so long. And it feels like maybe it's winding down. So anything bigger, definitely not. And as far as a yearly thing, we never based it on any kind of time frame. We just go strictly on request. And so, yeah, you could be seeing probably, you know, just in my opinion, of course, I mean, the end. But, you know, like I said, when we did that first tour in 2012, we thought that was it. And here we are 2 years later, many, many tours into it. So I leave that space for future opportunities for sure.
Yeah, definitely. And do you know if you have anything planned for 2015 you would like to share?
We do. We have a tour booked in Europe in February, March. I think it's around 20 shows. I'm not sure. Maybe it's over 20. So yeah, so it's a sizable tour. You know, we'll cover a lot of ground. We're going up to Scandinavia first time and hitting some markets we played before, some strong markets. Maybe going back in the summer, a couple of the, you know, the European summer festivals they have there, those are pretty big. This side of the ocean, though, nothing planned,
okay.
Nothing past this. So the people that came out on this tour to see, which, you know, pretty common consensus, this is probably the strongest lineup we've had. So lucky you got to catch it while it's there.
Definitely. And this is the last question. Do you have a message for the fans or anything?
Just not really, but, you know, I'd definitely like to thank everyone who's, you know, lend a positive ear towards what we're doing. There's been some criticism towards it, and that's understandable, but the majority of the people see that we're coming from a good place, you know, and we're just, I mean, what it boils down to is we're just playing music. We're not stealing the logo, we're not taking the name. There's no recordings going on, there's going to be no future projects out of this. You know, we're not pushing any merchandise or anything. I mean, there's, of course, they sell concert shirts, but that's normal. That's actually, you know, the band doesn't really have much to do with that. It's more of a kind of the, what do you call it, Perseverance Holdings or whatever. Yeah, so it's a corporation. But yeah, I mean, yeah, just it feels good to have positive, you know, support because we're doing it in a positive light. So, yeah, I like to thank the people that just enjoy to go along for the ride with us because it's a chance for us to, you know, not only, you know, kind of celebrate and honor what Chuck did, which is obviously pretty huge in the metal world, the underground metal world, but also a chance for us that met up at different times in different time frames to get back together. It's been a cool reunion, you know, and like I said, this lineup has a lot of top-level musicians, so it's been, you know, from my point of view, it's been challenging, and that's a great thing to have, you know, because sometimes you can get pretty stagnant playing this kind of music. Yeah, so that's what I mean. It's positive all the way around. It's positive within the lineup. It's positive on stage and meeting people. They generally enjoy it and thank us for, you know, kind of just lighting that flame once again for one more night, you know, and so just generally, like I say, thanks to those people.
And everybody, this is Stephanie here with The Age of Metal, and this was our interview with Steve DiGiorgio, so definitely keep up on everything the DTA is doing. Like Steve said, they have a lot of great touring in Europe next year, so keep up on that and stay metal.